This video on demand presentation of Big Red Wrap Up is made possible by the following sponsors. Big Red Wrap Up thanks these sponsors.
Coming up tonight on NET's Big Red Wrap Up. There was no need for a Hail Mary pass this time as Nebraska outmuscled Northwestern in the second half, securing a victory on the road. We'll recap the game with former Huskers Cory Ross and Ron Kellogg III. We'll also be joined by Sean Callahan to update us on Big Red recruiting. Hi, everybody. I'm Kevin Kugler, and welcome to NET's Big Red Wrap-Up. Good weekend for Nebraska on the road at Northwestern as they get the win resounding fashion over the Wildcats. And then today, the big news. The black shirts are handed out. You should have been in the studio earlier. My colleagues, Adrian, Fiala, and Blake Lawrence, both black shirts, running around, hooping and hollering. It reminded me of that scene in the Steve Martin movie, The Jerk, where the phone books arrive. It was very exciting.
Yes.
The phone books are here. The black shirts are here.
It was very, very similar to that.
You were you were pumped up. Blake was pumped up. 16 black shirts get handed out today.
Nothing better. very glad to see it finally happen because I was getting a little bit annoyed, let's put it that way, at the whole situation to the point where I'd almost kind of put it aside. But I'm really glad the coaches decided it's time to do it, and those players deserve it, no question about it. I'm still in the old school where I think black shirts ought to go out, you know, right after fall camp. But, you know, their times change and thoughts change. But finally get there, and the black shirts go out. And so I'm really happy for those guys. I know they're happy. So let's hope that it'll translate into great play.
Blake, it's a treasured artifact. I know for everybody who has played on the defensive side, those black shirts go under glass when you're done playing.
Yep.
Frame them on the wall. I assume yours is in a position of honor just like Adrian's are?
My black shirt is used as, like, a sleeping shirt by my girlfriend, which I think is kind of cool. But
wait,
I only got
wait,
one.
What was that?
Well, no, I mean, it's a carry. You know what? We'll just leave it be. All right, we'll leave.
I thought you said that.
That's exactly what I said. But
okay.
But the tradition is great, and I think that if anyone deserves it, a black shirt, it might be Coach Papuchis and the defensive adjustments in the second half and up in Evanston. And actually, Evanston. Now, Kev, you went up to Evanston.
I did.
I went up to Evanston.
Yes.
And I'd like the viewers to maybe take a look and say, you know,
yeah,
who had more fun in Evanston here, Kev?
I'm eating a Giordano's stuffed pizza. I win. Period.
But we are there in the stands.
Yeah.
This is after the game.
I will say your choice of companion is a little better looking than my choice of companion.
Yeah,
but
most definitely.
I mean, but yeah, it's a great city. We had a great time. Northwestern hospitable hosts to be around. It was a fine evening.
I think there's different ways to enjoy the city, but the game was great, and it was good to see that second half of this team really come together. There's a lot of things you can take away from the second half, scheme-wise, just play-wise, but a lot of confidence. Maybe black shirts were deserved.
Oh, I think so. No doubt about it. I'm of the opinion they earned those things. After spring and after fall, get them then and let's go. But, you know, they got them, and that's all that counts. It really does.
Well, they've got them, and we've got you, and you're a major part of our show, and we want to hear from you tonight. We've got no black shirts, but we've got Nebraska's Phi Gamma Delta, the Fijis. All right, yeah, throwing the bones. Standing by in our call center for all your phone questions and comments. They're enjoying some Valentino's pizza while they wait for your call. Our NET Sports intern, Josh, is heading the charge in the call center. We'll hear from him later on as well. There are plenty of ways to reach us tonight with your questions. You can email, you can Facebook, you can tweet us. You can still download an 8x10 version of our schedule poster while you're on the web tonight. Just log on to netnebraska.org. Click the poster tab and you can download and print from home. And don't forget, you can also download our NET Nebraska app. Watch live streaming of our show, catch up on previous episodes, check out features and much more. Just head to your app store and download the NET Nebraska app today. Black shirt discussion aside, and I'm sure we'll get into that as the show goes on a little bit more, but Nebraska went on the road after the bye week, got some guys back and healthy a little bit, and did they take strides, Aid, from where they were at the end of Michigan State to where they are now at the end of Northwestern?
Kevin, most definitely, and I think principally in the offensive line And that was one of the things I think we talked about last week, is that offensive line really had to rebound and come back and play well, and they did that. And we saw some new people come in to the offensive line and do that. Chago Condolo and Gibbons Price came back and got the job done. And so all those guys really rebounded well and rallied and blocked well up front. Now, the other thing that we talked about, which I think was even either of equal importance or even maybe more importance, was ball security. We had played Northwestern the last three games and given the ball away 9 times, and that created 17 points for them. Saturday, we didn't give it away at all. As a matter of fact, we were plus one in the takeaways, and we got 7 points off of that. So I think the fact that the line played the way they did and the takeaway situation resulted the way it did, that really went a long ways in terms of how that game was going to come out.
What'd you see from your vantage point in the stands next to your lovely girlfriend wearing your black shirt?
You know, I saw a team that in the first half, the Nebraska offense, you can say that Northwestern stopped certain plays, but I think that Nebraska just missed by a little bit. Maybe a screen pass here that was overthrown or a missed block here. But overall, the offense brought a good scheme into the first half. In the second half, you saw Amir break out a little bit, get a little bit more running room. But Northwestern did a good job of bottling him up and you know, kind of putting some pressure on the offense to find other ways to get downfield, which they did. And the emergence of DeMornay Pearson L on offense, I think we all are excited about that. Absolutely. Where he's running the ball, catching the ball, throwing the ball. Whatever he's going to do, I think he's going to give a spark to this offense throughout the rest of the year.
Yeah, they gave the other teams were going to play something else to have to prepare for.
Right.
Which is really great.
Isn't what Nebraska was able to do, and that was wear down Northwestern a little bit, and you saw more offense from the ground game in the second half. Isn't that kind of what Nebraska's built to do?
It's always been that way.
Yeah.
You know, we try to get teams into the third quarter, about midway through the third quarter, on into the fourth, and just bury them in the third and fourth quarter. And that's kind of what happened Saturday. I mean, the conditioning and the strength and just the overall play of what happened Saturday, really, Kevin, is what you're talking about. The tradition of Nebraska football really raised its beautiful head in that two quarters.
Well, here are the results of last week's sideline survey. We asked you, what worries you about Nebraska heading into the second half of the season? 51% of you think it's the offensive line. This was before last week. 26% went with the passing game. 18% thought mindset. 5% of you were worried about the schedule. Time now for our all-new sideline survey. How would you characterize Nebraska at this point in the season? An offensive team? A defensive team? A balanced team? Or none? They're just, I don't know what you voted none for, but, you know, there's not a lot of other, maybe they're a special teams team. Go to our Facebook or wrap-up website and cast your vote in our very unscientific sideline survey. To the highlights we go. And beautiful Ryan Field in Evanston on a nice night for football. It was a chilly night, but it wasn't too bad. It rained most of the morning up there, and then things got going. It was dry. It was comfortable. It was hoodie weather for Bo Pelini as the Husker head coach and for the Northwestern head coach, Pat Fitzgerald, in their different uniforms. Simeon to Vitaly, 13-yard gain to the Nebraska 25-yard line. He's the super back, but really, for Northwestern, their super back is this freshman, Justin Jackson. They've got a nice little talent here in this running back who rushed for over 6,000 yards in his high school career, and Justin Jackson finishing off a 15-play, 89-yard drive with a 2-yard run. Third straight week for Justin Jackson to go over the 100-yard mark on the ground. He's talented, and it was 7-0 Northwestern.
And once again, Kevin, the opponent scores first. And in Northwestern's case, anytime they scored first this year, they end up winning the game, but that did not happen in this game.
Trevor Siemian going deep, trying for the home run ball, and instead Nathan Gary is there for the interception, and then back to the air. Tommy Armstrong, Jordan Westerkamp, a little hurdle action to the Nebraska 43-yard line. Still in the second quarter, still in the same possession. Tommy on the keeper. And Tommy Armstrong with a good block on that left side all the way down to the 1-yard line. Amir Abdullah would finish it off on the very next play on first and goal. His first touchdown. There would be others. That's called foreshadowing, kid. 7-7, Nebraska and Northwestern all tied up. Northwestern back to work. Siemian to Buckley. Guy who switched over from running back to wide receivers. Got some speed down to the 39-yard line. Then on third and 6, Miles Schuler catches it out of bounds. The penalty for roughing the passer moves it down to the 5-yard line. Jackson into the end zone. Nice little spin, nice little hurdle. 14-7 Northwestern, and Jackson capping the 10-play, 88-yard drive.
You know, at this point, you got to start thinking that is Nebraska's defense ready to stop this run? Simeon's throwing the ball well, but it's going to change to get to the second half.
DeMornay Pearsonell, big play. We'll see this, a big play from him later on, but this one 46 yards all the way down to the 27-yard line. Tommy Armstrong to the air once more. A little short pass, finds Amir Abdullah, who does the rest of the work and gets that first down for Nebraska on a first and 10. And now you get the razzle-dazzle, as the fine broadcaster called it. DeMornay Pearsonell to Tommy Armstrong into the end zone, tied the game at 14.
And Kevin, what was really significant about that set of plays, in about 34, 35 seconds, Nebraska answered that touchdown by Northwestern and put themselves right back in the game and told the Wildcats, you're not going anywhere. We got your number, and it worked out from there.
No quitting these Cats as they come charging back and get into good position. On the end of that play, Mitchell with a 29-yard field goal, and Jack Mitchell gives Northwestern a 17-14 lead at the break. Wildcats feeling good. They're going into the locker room with a halftime lead, but Nebraska would come out and they would start to flex their formidable muscle. Tommy Armstrong happy to get Kenny Bell back, and Kenny Bell happy for the second half, very strong second half after a little rust in that first half. Tommy Armstrong back to DeMornay Pearsonell, right out of bounds at the 1-yard line. Amir Abdullah doing his best touchdown vulture play, gets into the end zone from 1 yard out, 21-17. Nebraska would grab the lead, a lead they would not relinquish.
What I love about that drive is the third down conversions. Nebraska's offense has proven they can get the third down conversion. They did it all night on Saturday.
Nice toss from Tommy Armstrong to Moore, and Moore just shy of midfield. Second down and 9, Amir Abdullah. About 50 yards for Amir Abdullah. Nice little cutback for Amir. Amir all the way down, caught just shy of the goal line at the 1-yard line. I know our guest Cory Ross would never have gotten caught. We'll ask him about that later on. Amir Abdullah into the end zone, 1 yard for the touchdown. 28-17, Nebraska with the lead. Amir Abdullah again on the ground. And Amir Abdullah looking for running room, finding running room, making running room down to the 42-yard line. Tommy Armstrong a couple of plays later with what looked to be the highlight of the game. Initially ruled as a touchdown as he reached across the goal line. Tommy Armstrong doing the best Edwin Moses he can, hurdling, and he falls just short of Amir Abdullah. Comes the vulture again. Fourth touchdown. Amir Abdullah gets the score, 35-17. Nebraska with the lead. Husker defense. Mr. Williams coming through 2.5 sacks. See an extended playing time. Great to see him having that kind of an impact. Radone on the punt. One of the things Pat Fitzgerald wanted to do, keep it away from DeMornay Pearsonell because he is a weapon. 15-yard return to the 19-yard line. Huskers would then cap the night of scoring with a field goal. 33 yards from Drew Brown, 38-17. Nebraska with the lead and the eventual win, 38-17. Huskers get the victory, winning on the road. And the final numbers, 471 total yards for Nebraska. Not bad balance, 234, 237. More important, 0 in the turnover category. Eight, I know it's something that's, you look at the very first thing you grab a box score, no turnovers.
Absolutely, Kevin. That's such a key to any game anymore is how many times that team has given it away. And the Huskers were able to maintain possession, not only maintain possession, but also take it away from Northwestern and pick up points after that. So it was a great moment, a great moment in the game for them to be able to do that. So well done, well played, and I'm anxious for the rest of the season to keep going and get down the road.
It's time for this week's trivia question. Be the first correct caller. You're going to receive a very special gift. If it, of course, the Big Red Wrap-Up T-shirt, size extra large, and the Hale Varsity 2014 yearbook. Nebraska's rushing offense got back on track this past Saturday against Northwestern as Amir Abdullah rushed for 146 yards, 22nd career 100-yard rushing game. Also scored on 4 rushing touchdowns, all from the 1, becoming the first Husker to score 4 rushing touchdowns in a game since 2010. Tonight's first question is, who was the last Cornhusker to score 4 rushing touchdowns at a game? You already know the year if you're listening. Be the first correct caller, and you'll receive the wrap-up tee and the Hale Varsity 2014 yearbook. It's now time to go deeper into the playbook with Blake Lawrence in the huddle.
Tonight in the huddle, we'll take a look at Kevin Williams' 2.5 sacks against Northwestern on Saturday night. The first half sack is set up by a pick by the defensive end, Jack Gangwish. Jack is going to come down and pick the offensive guard, which is going to allow Kevin Williams to come around the edge untouched to tackle the quarterback. Here's the pick by Gangwish. Kevin Williams comes over, gets his hands on the quarterback. Gangwish gets the ball on the ground, and this is a little of a Gangwish celebration segment as well. Jack Gangwish has got some great celebrations. The ball's on the ground. He doesn't care. He's throwing the bones. One of my favorite defensive players this year. The second play, a great individual effort by Kevin Williams. Kevin, he's going to get upfield with pressure. Just keep your eyes on him. The quarterback has to step up in the pocket because the defensive ends are collapsing on him. So as he steps up, keep your eyes on Kevin Williams. The way he spins, it makes me think he's going to be a great individual player this year on the defensive line. He spins right into it, gets Simeon down. And then, okay, there's Gangwish again. He's once again celebrating. That's awesome. Okay, well, the second of the full sacks of the night for Kevin Williams comes on a screen play. So Northwestern's receiver and their lineman, they're supposed to block these two guys. Well, Nebraska, they're in a blitz. So those two guys aren't going to block anyone. And that means that the quarterback's going to get tackled by, well, Kevin Williams. And then Jack Gangwish is going to do some fun celebrations. But what I love about these plays is Kevin Williams was able to demonstrate that you can make plays in the backfield without having to use a blitz. And that's what Nebraska did a great job on Saturday.
Also, it shows you can do it with four guys, too. You don't need to have an extra guy or two coming in for pressure.
And so many times, if you watch the first half, you can see that the times when Simeon gets the ball thrown downfield, it's because those blitzes, they weren't getting there fast enough, and these secondaries is kind of on an island when you're doing a blitz. But if you can get pressure with only rushing four guys,
all the better.
That's what we need to do the rest of the season.
Well, that's been one of the things that Nebraska has been especially happy about this year is the ability on a pretty regular basis to get pressure with its front four. And when you look back in the history of Bo Pelini, whether as a defensive coordinator or as a head coach, his best defenses, not coincidentally, have been those that have been able to establish that line of scrimmage and get pressure with that front four. And I think you could say that probably about any very good defensive coach. Always better when you got those guys up front that can carry a lot of that pass rush burden.
If you can do that with your front people, that frees up your backers to do a lot of things. I mean, it really gives you a lot of versatility.
More guys in coverage.
Yeah, just a lot of versatility on defense if those front four people can do what they're doing right now. Let's hope that keeps going.
It will.
Yeah.
This Saturday, Nebraska welcomes Big Ten newcomer Rutgers for their first ever trip to Lincoln. Since Nebraska's only faced the Scarlet Knights once, way back in 1920, we thought we'd give you a quick heads up on Rutgers in this Big Ten bio.
Helping to expand the Big Ten this season is the inclusion of Rutgers University. Commonly referred to as the birthplace of college football, the State University of New Jersey was founded in 1776, then known as Queens College. With an enrollment of over 65,000 students, Rutgers is the farthest east Big Ten school. The Scarlet Knights call High Point Solutions Stadium home. Seating over 52,000, the stadium has seen the team transition from the Big East to the ACC to their new home in the Big Ten over the last 20 years. Coach Kyle Flood's team is led by senior quarterback Gary Nova, who ranks among the best quarterbacks in the nation. Rutgers and Nebraska have met just once in this series, with the Huskers on top after a decisive victory in 1920.
Rutgers making its way into Lincoln Saturday for an early kickoff after five straight night games for the Huskers. Next up, we're joined by former Huskers Cory Ross and Ron Kellogg III. As we go to break, let's enjoy some images from Nebraska's win in Evanston, courtesy Aaron Babcock from Hale Varsity. Stay with us. We're back in just a moment.
you're not going to go three and out every series. Well, I'd like to, but you're not going to. But when teams get you reeling a little bit, you got to, you know, we have to make a play.
I feel like in the second half we did a really good job of that. In the first half, we had a lot of opportunities to get off the field. We just didn't tackle.
No, you don't want to go in there and, you know, third and two, third and three, because there's only a limited amount of things you can do then. So, you know, I think I'm pretty confident that on third down, you know, we get after it. I'm pretty pleased where we're at thus far in the season.
Welcome back to NET's Big Red Wrap-Up. I'm Kevin Kugler, joined by our NET Sports intern, Josh. Hello, Josh.
Hey.
What are we seeing tonight on social media other than people wanting to wrap Josh up and take him home for Christmas? It's nice that your aunt can use the computer today and get on there and make some comments.
Absolutely. Well, there's a lot of traffic wondering how Nebraska can use DeMorne Pearson-L as more of a weapon, because he's shown that he's an electric player. And also people are wondering, we went into the halftime down by three and then came out and outscored him 24-0. And people want to know what it was like in the locker room and the halftime adjustments that were made there at half. And we also have some pretty good tweets here this week. Eric Crouch, speaking of DeMorne Pearson-L, he had a nice little play that hailed back to the Mike Stunts to Eric Crouch connection against Oklahoma, and he said, hey, that's my play. And Fopolini, be honest, were you alarmed when you first heard we were going with all whites last night? A little play on words there with the all-white uniforms. And the Nebraska baseball team just finished up their red-white series, and the Nebraska Huskers tweeted, that is not Fopolini, that is actually senior Blake Headley with Cory Stringer in there, dressed up as the Black Power Ranger. They wore Halloween costumes, as you can see. And there's the coach, Darren Erstad, in full Chewbacca for the Huskers.
Very cool. It was fun to watch those pictures come across Twitter today of all the guys doing the red-white series in uniform. Josh, thanks.
No problem.
We've got a winner in our first trivia question. Dennis Morris knew the answer to this question. The last Cornhusker to score four rushing touchdowns in a game, Taylor Martinez against Kansas State in 2010. Here's tonight's second trivia question. Open to email, Facebook, and Twitter. Have the first correct answer, and you'll receive a copy of The Legend of Little Red for those junior Huskers out there, and the Big Red Wrap-Up tee, size extra large. Nebraska had a few big offensive plays that helped it to a 38-17 road win on Saturday. None more memorable than DeMorne Pearson-L's 16-yard touchdown strike to Tommy Armstrong that tied the game up late in the second quarter. Tonight's second question, who was the last Nebraska quarterback to have a touchdown reception in a game? Have the first correct answer out of email, Facebook, Twitter, and you'll receive The Legend of Little Red and the wrap-up tee. Before we introduce our guests, we wanted to take a quick look back at last year, a game and a final moment that's one for the ages in Nebraska football.
It's going to be tipped and caught! It's caught!
One of the most thrilling endings to a game at Memorial Stadium, this 2013 come-from-behind victory over Northwestern was an instant classic. Before the pandemonium began, the Huskers were down 21-14 at halftime, and it was the defense that came up big in the second half.
Second down and 11, picked off!
In the middle of the third quarter, redshirt freshman defensive end Avery Moss got things started by a 25-yard pick six. Under 2 minutes to play, with Northwestern threatening from the Husker one-yard line, the blackshirts stepped up once again, holding the Wildcats to a field goal. With 1:14 left to play, enter Ron Kellogg III. RK3 led the offense down to midfield before this moment in Husker history ensued.
Got to get rid of it. Throw it up there.
Kellogg's throw. It's going to be tipped and caught! It's caught! It's caught in the touchdown, Western Tabs!
Hard to believe that was just a year ago as we welcome in our guest, former Husker Cory Ross, and last year's Geronimo-heaving quarterback, Ron Kellogg III. Gentlemen, it's a pleasure to have you with us. Cory, good to have you back. And Ron, good to have you on for the first
time. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
It is very good to have both of you here. As you guys have watched, let's just start general, and then we've got a list of questions that people are sending in for each of you, social media-wise. So we'll get to a lot of those. Keep your questions coming. Cory and Ron are going to answer as many as we can tonight. But Cory, let me start with you, and then we'll work with Ron. Just generally, what have you seen from this team progressing through this year?
Oh, man, I see a four-quarter football team. You know, bottom line, I think we all get a little frustrated with, you know, the third downs and getting off the field, especially this last game. But, I mean, we forget, and I myself forget as a fan now, too, that the other team has players too. They're going to play and they're going to make plays just like we do. And we get down early and we don't start fast right now, but we finish very, very strong. So that's what, for me, you know, I never really get too scared about what's going on in the first half.
Ron, your thoughts just overall on the progression of this team so far to this point?
I think from the first game to where we're at now, I feel like our offensive line play has improved a lot, especially from last year. A lot of people didn't think we were going to be great in that position, but they've proved everyone wrong. Amir Abdullah, still the captain as always. Kenny Bell, even though the groin injury's hurting him a little bit, still is able to go out there and perform. And then the big factor, Tommy Armstrong, that was a big question that everyone had. What are we going to do without Taylor Martinez? And I think he's shutting everybody up too.
I would assume, knowing him as well as you do, you kind of expected this from him, didn't you?
Well, he had signs of that all season last year, especially when we put him in tough situations against Michigan State. Yeah, we lost, but he made big strides as an athlete and as a quarterback. It just took a little bit of time, and I felt like he worked on his craft a lot, especially being with Brett Favre over the summer. Not too many people can go wrong with going with a legend like that.
Walter, via the Facebook page, has a question for Cory. Pork Chop Ross, do you think the Husker offense would benefit by getting Amir the ball more via the screen pass? I assume you'd believe to get him in space anywhere.
Yeah, and I think that's where I was a little excited this past game. I thought Tim Beck called probably the best game he's called all year. I mean, obviously, we missed a couple plays, dropped some passes and things like that, but that screen call, I just saw grass green, and it just was just a little bit overthrown. But, yeah, of course, I mean, when you got teams like Michigan State and even in the first half, Northwestern, you know, was pretty much stopping the run and really putting some pressure on Amir Abdullah. And I think the screen game, getting him the ball in the open field, he just does some remarkable things with the ball in his hand, so why not try that?
You know, another guy that has kind of emerged and – DeMornay, you didn't even get to play with him, Ron, so I bet you've probably seen him at practice. But a guy like that, I mean, how do you get DeMornay Personnel involved with the game more, or what do you expect? Ron, I mean, you know this playbook. There's probably something drawn up in there. Just
I feel like what they're doing now, letting him fill it out with the punt return game, is working a little bit. I also feel like the jet sweep is going to be a big thing for him, too. When we're giving the ball to Amir Abdullah up the middle all the time, people are going to start keying in on him like they already have been. Just giving him the ball. He's got enough speed to go out. Plus, he's a great slot receiver. He proved that this Saturday.
Ron, it looks like it looks like Tommy is really coming on well. Mm-hmm. But what do you see in terms of where he needs to improve the most? Or what does he need to do to get even better and better? I said today on the show, consistency is what he needs. What do you think?
I think consistency is a big thing. That's a big thing for any quarterback in the D1 level. But the thing I noticed that might be be tweaked a little bit is his confidence in the pocket. I have noticed that sometimes when the pocket breaks down, he likes to get out of there really fast. Yeah, it's been a good thing for us, positive yards-wise, but I think there's been some times where he could have just moved his feet, kick slide in the pocket, throw it to an open receiver, and take off hits from him.
Kyle wants to give a shout-out to Cory for his pass blocking. That guy never got enough credit for picking up the blitz. Great pass blocker. You were, and I'll say this, you were not a large running back from a stature standpoint, but you played like a bigger back in roles such as pass protection. How difficult was it for you as a star in high school to come in and learn to pass protect? Because I can't imagine you were asked to do that a ton during your high school career.
Well, I mean, people, I say it all the time when they ask me about it, but, you know, Eric Bieniemy was my high school running back coach. And so I took pride in that because he took pride in it. And he's the one that told me, hey, anybody can run, anybody coming out of high school, 4 or 5 star, can be the best player because they're getting the ball, what you do without the ball. And he's taught me a long time. And so when I came here, it was usually just option left, option right under Solis. So it really wasn't any, you know, protection scheme going on. And when Coach Callahan and Randy Jordan came in, I really felt like it was going to be my time to shine because I actually was in an offense like that. And, man, I took pride in that, man. I think I had an interview, and I told Dungy at the NFL Combine. I said, hey, you know, that's what I get. That's what I get my thrill out of. I can run the football. I can score touchdowns. But when I block somebody who they think is going to run me over, I'm going to do my thing.
Kyle, via the Facebook, what has the offensive line changed, Ron, since the Michigan State game? Why did they look better against Northwestern?
I feel like they looked better because they were getting a push. We didn't really see too much push going on during the Michigan State game. They did towards the second half against the Michigan State game. I think Michigan State thought they won the game already, but that's just my opinion. Mm-hmm. But the Northwestern game, apparently we took out the entire right side.
Yep.
And they didn't touch the field again. I didn't notice that.
Yeah.
But it was a difference because we started running the ball on the right side of the field.
Austin wants to know, should we continue wearing the all-white uniforms for future away games? Cory, you were a style guy. I remember having a conversation years ago about spatten shoes and how to make sure that all looked right. I know you cared a lot about that.
I did.
As a style guru, do you like the all-white?
Yes, of course, absolutely. Last time, I don't even guys remember, we wore all-white, and that was when Larry Johnson played at Penn State, and yep. We were number 7 and got pretty whooped. And
everyone,
Everyone hated that. But the all white is beautiful. I'm a jersey fanatic though, man. I think that kills in recruiting and things like that. And kids nowadays really like just love the style of jerseys. And you see what's going on with the colleges nowadays, just bringing out all kind of alternative jerseys. So yeah, definitely love the all white.
Were you guys fans of the all whites, Ron?
Well, we never got to wear them.
Never.
Yeah, you're really sad about that.
Yeah, tweeted about that. I'm pretty sure I tweeted about that. I wanted to wear all whites just once, but I'm sure I probably would have got made fun of looking like a marshmallow.
So, okay. So there's an upside to that.
There's an upside. Yeah, there's a positive.
That's a good thing. That's a very good thing.
Yeah. Well, looking at this team, I mean, we can talk about Amir Abdullah. We talk about Tommy Armstrong, Kenny Bell. Some of these guys, Westerkamp, even coming on last year. But who has been a surprise? Who's the new face that you're excited about for this team, you know, either just for 1 year or for the future?
Ryan Reeves. At center. I know there's some times where we practiced where he wasn't too confident in snapping the football, but after seeing him play the center position and be able to snap, call out blitzes, call out protections, I think he's a big impact player for us, especially if Mark Pelini were to go down for the rest of the season. Just throw him in there.
Hmm. Cody, you got anybody?
For me, I think really was just Williams is this D tackle. I think his story for me really just touched me, you know, being injured and going through what he's going through, and to come out and play the way he played against Northwestern. I mean, you can't help but to get the guy on the field some more. I think he was a key part to what we did against Northwestern that second half.
I'm just intrigued with Pearson L and what he's doing.
Well, of course.
How do you see his role evolve? I mean, we know what he can do so far. Other ways that he can be part of this offense or other things on the field?
I think just the more reps he gets.
Running back?
I like him in the slot. I really do like him in the slot. You see his confidence getting more and more when you see him catching those punt returns, and he's getting so confident back there. And now he's caught a couple passes. He's the type of guy that once he gets used to doing something, he might just explode and be that playmaker we think he should be.
I think it's the way he runs that will move him slowly but surely into some positions where he can be the running back. And you'll see Amir and him in the backfield. Knowing Tim Beck, that's probably something he's already been brewing up at home.
Guys, the other day I talked to Johnny Rogers, and Johnny made the counter trap at Nebraska one of the golden plays ever and got a lot of yards out of that play. Would you see a guy like L being able to run that? The reason I think it's a little bit doubtful is because of the ability of defenses these days to smell those things out pretty quick and to close it so quick. But what do you think about that possible situation?
I mean, that's always a possible situation, but it depends on how long we've worked on it. So we can't just throw that in there and be like, hey, we got to run this to perfection. But I think the stuff that we already got going in with the game plan, with the fake speed sweeps, running the ball up the middle, giving the speed sweep, I think that's plenty for us.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. You have to come with – you have to have some reps with that. Running between the tackle, I just don't know if he – it's different now being a running back. You gotta understand vision, being patient back there. So I think having some reps with it, maybe he can do well.
Okay. Sam Vizzano on Twitter tweets, look, Mom, I'm on TV. We're not reading that tweet, Sam. You're not on TV. Sorry. Sam Vizzano's tweet is not getting on TV. Sorry, Sam Vizzano. You're not getting on TV. Ski jumper Husker,
Is that his name?
That's his Twitter handle. Like Ski Jumper Husker. Okay. I love that. I didn't even know Nebraska had a ski jump team. Wow. Don't get too comfortable with zero turnovers. Tommy threw a pick that was dropped. It hit him in the numbers. Your thought? I mean,
is that to me?
Yeah, I think it's just a general comment about how don't get too comfortable with zero turnovers, because he could have had one, but should have, would have.
I feel like you can have a turnover on every down. But gladly we didn't. Again, that comes with experience, I guess. It's only his second year playing, and now it's really all his.
Yeah.
So, yes, the guy might have dropped the interception, or he would have caught it. Who cares? We'll be fine.
I like jumper. That. I like that answer.
We could all climb the Matterhorn last week, too.
Anyway. Kangaroo wants to know if you think Nebraska will make it to the Big Ten Championship. Does this look like a championship-caliber team to you, Cory?
Yeah, right now. I mean, our conference isn't as strong. I mean, obviously, we'll get back. I can't wait to see what happens with the playoff system and things like that. I think if we get there, we definitely have a chance for it. But, yeah, I mean, right now, Northwestern was one of the teams that scared me. I say Minnesota is the next team. But we get past Minnesota, I don't see why not.
Couldn't agree more.
Yeah, Minnesota's off to a good start, 3-0 in conference. As you see, they're 6-1, tied with Nebraska. Overall record, of course, undefeated in conference. The back end of Minnesota's schedule is going to be a real test for them. They also get Ohio State. And people are asking, is Rutgers as bad as they looked against Ohio State, or is Ohio State getting better every single week? I tend to lean towards Ohio State's getting better every single week, Ron.
I tend to agree with that, especially with the quarterback, true freshman. So he's getting used to being a D1 athlete. Now it looks like he's starting to get a lot of confidence in it, which is scary for the Big Ten, especially on that side of the field. But Rutgers apparently is a hard-nosed team. I haven't really watched too much of them. Only saw a little bit of the game against Penn State. But if they still are willing to be a team that's four quarters, I think we should have a pretty good game this Saturday.
Chris with a tweet, and I'm interested in your guys' thoughts on this, because Chris says, Nebraska finally did what they should do. They should win by 20 every week with the talent gap. That's a pretty lofty expectation in this era of college football, isn't it, Cory, to go out and say, if they don't win by 20 every week, it's a disappointing week?
Well, it just goes into what happened to us early on. Everyone was just so scared and so frightened about what happened with McNeese State. But they have a ton of talent. I mean, they're getting transfers from all over the country. And right now, schools are starting to get the top talent. I mean, all these schools are starting to compete. It's a new era, man. And these top schools aren't getting the best teams or the best players in the country. Guys and families are really trying to understand, academics and things like that, coaching and seeing if they have that family atmosphere. That's why Nebraska's doing so well. I think the coaches do a great job at instilling family and overall leadership here.
Now, Ron, a lot of things in this offseason, you started to hear about Coach Beck and the offense being simplified in terms of the way they call plays and that sort of thing. How much of that have you seen, that it's more simple, I guess, the schemes? And then if we just as fans, and I was always on the defensive side, I never knew what you guys were doing on offense. I never knew what you were doing back in the day. But is everything that will be called for the rest of the year already in the playbook, or does this thing grow, and how simple is it compared to last year?
Well, when they say simplify, to me that means nothing else is going to get thrown in the playbook. That's something that we've done every time I was in the quarterback room, a new play was coming in. And I think that's stopped. And you can tell the playbook has been simplified a little bit because now the signals aren't as long. When I watch the plays, the only person I look at is Joe Gans. Or whoever's the main head caller. It could be Coach Fisher. It could be the backups. No one really knows. But I do notice that everything is quick and to the point. And Tommy's not up there messing around with offensive linemen trying to figure out the call of the scheme. It's quick, to the point, and they go.
Is it safe to say that Joe Gans would like it if every play, every single person was looking at Joe Gans and just gazing upon how great Joe is?
Well, I mean, Joe Gans is a great-looking individual. But not everyone looks at Joe Gans, because there's different play callers. No one really knows. But Joe can take all the credit. It's fine.
Yeah. Doug says, why doesn't anyone run the full house set anymore? Corey, how come nobody's in a full house set in the backfield anymore?
I'm seeing a lot of it in high school still. So. I'm just a little shocked as how many people run a pistol, no huddle scheme now in college as well. That goes on with each era. I think it was option. A lot of teams ran option. It was pro style. Then when West Coast offense came in, people started trying to run the West Coast. And now it's this run and gun type of a scheme, which, you know, I think it just goes with each era.
Brian says this question is for Ron Kellogg. Are you worried about Nebraska giving the easy catches to the opponents in the 5 to 15 yard range? Is our coverage too soft?
Oh, man.
I know, that's a defensive kind of question to a quarterback.
Well, as long as it's in front of them, that's fine. Now, when they catch the 5 to 10 yard pass, now we have to tackle. That's the most important thing. So I'll let them throw the ball short as long as they want, as long as we're making stops.
The odds of them going 10, 12, 15 yard, 15 plays, I should say, that as a coach, Corey, that's something you'd probably rather see, a team have to matriculate their way down the field as opposed to hitting the big play.
Yeah, you do not want the big plays. I mean, the little ones here and there work because eventually something happens and someone on defense will make a play. Someone on D-line will make a sack. You want to give up that little stuff in front of you. That's okay. But like Ron said, you have to be able to tackle if you're going to give up that.
Well, Corey, you mentioned earlier about Minnesota. I think if there's one thing, guys, that really impresses me about Minnesota is the way they tackle. Because we saw a lot of short stuff against them, but nobody gets past their guys. They tackle about as well as any team I've seen thus far this year. So that's what our guys have to do. So, you want 5 yards, take it, but I'm going to get you right there.
Right.
Yeah.
Steve wants to know if, Ron, if you're looking into coaching now that you've finished playing college ball.
Well, I coached peewee football. thinking firefighters, that was an experience, let me tell you.
How'd they do?
We finished 4-3.
Did you run a Hail Mary every play?
I mean, we tried to. We did a lot of jet sweeps, though. I tried to run a lot of plays that the kids wouldn't enjoy.
Right.
But it depends on if I get a phone call saying, hey, Ron, do you want to come coach? Yeah, I'll come coach. But it depends on when that phone calls.
All right. Well, we'll post Ron's number on our website. Yep. You can call him and just ask him random questions if you'd like or talk to him about coaching. Ron Kellogg. Corey Ross, such a pleasure to have you both with us. Always a joy. We appreciate you coming out and spending a few minutes with us tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Up next on the wrap-up, Sean Callahan is here with all the latest Big Red recruiting news. And as we go to break, let's take another look at Nebraska's victory against Northwestern. Courtesy Aaron Babcock at Hail Varsity. We're back in just a couple of minutes. Thanks for joining us tonight on The Wrap-Up. I'm Kevin Kugler. Be sure to vote on this week's sideline survey question. How would you characterize Nebraska at this point in the season? 64% of you say this is a balanced team. 17% of you were not aware that the season had started. 14% say defensive team and 5% an offensive team. Visit our Facebook page or The Wrap-Up website and vote in our unscientific poll. Want to congratulate Marcus Metcalf, who knew the answer to this Big Red trivia question. The last Nebraska quarterback to have a touchdown reception in a game. You mentioned his name just a little while ago. Joe Gans caught a 20-yard pass from Marlon Lucky against New Mexico State in 2008. We all know injuries are a part of the game. We're here with some help to understand some of the big ones. Once again, here's Injury Replay with Dr. Rob Rhodes.
Hi, I'm Dr. Rob Rhodes from Injury Replay. Welcome to Injury Minute. Today we're talking about the medial collateral ligament, or MCL. It's one of the four major ligaments of the knee. The MCL connects the femur or thigh bone to the tibia or shin bone on the medial or inside part of the knee. The MCL resists widening of the inside of the joint. The MCL is usually injured by pressure or stress on the outside part of the knee, such as a block to the knee in football. Injuries to the MCL can be isolated or can also occur in conjunction with damage to other ligaments or cartilage. MCL injuries are graded on a scale of 1 to 3 and range from an incomplete tear to a full tear. Fortunately, surgery isn't usually necessary for an isolated MCL injury. Treatment usually includes bracing, physical therapy, and rest. Recovery times vary depending on the grade of the injury, going from 1 week to 3 months out. I'm Dr. Rob Rhodes with Injury Replay, and this has been your Injury Minute.
Time now to welcome Sean Callahan, who's here from Husker Online. Hi, Sean.
Hey, guys.
Home game, but an 11 a.m. start. Does that hurt the official visitors for this weekend?
It does, and you mentioned 28 days now between home games for Nebraska. Same thing happened last year at this time as well, but luckily Nebraska had some night games. The fact the game, though, is at 11, there isn't any confirmed official visitors. Kendall Bussey, Nebraska's star running back recruit, was hoping to come in, but because now the game is at 11, he's not going to be able to make the flights into Lincoln.
So five straight night games. Good in some ways, at least when they were home, because you could get those folks in. You may go a weekend without having anybody on your radar that you want to get in for a home game.
Yeah, in terms of flying in, the only way they could do it is if they don't play Friday. Otherwise, it's got to be a driving distance. Even, say, Kansas City, you know, that's a pretty tough drive in the morning. You know, you got to get up pretty early to get up here. So it's not easy with those 11 a.m. kickoffs.
Well, one guy we know who won't be up here, but certainly Florida to Nebraska would be a little bit of a jaunt for an 11 a.m. game. Mirko Jurkovic Jr. joining us here on Big Red Wrap-Up. Mirko, it's a pleasure to have you with us. How are you this evening?
I'm doing great. How about yourself?
We are doing great. We appreciate you taking time for us this evening here on Big Red Wrap-Up. What most excites you about Nebraska?
Just the atmosphere of everything going up there and all the coaches and everything.
Mirko, you're from Indiana, but you go down and play at the IMG Academy in Florida. Chris Wanky, the former Heisman winner from Florida State, your coach. What is that like playing at almost kind of an academy football factory type program where you're at, and how much better has it made you?
Oh, it's an awesome opportunity. You got to come down here and work at our game basically every day, and coaches here are unbelievable. They're preparing you for the next level and stuff. So by the time we all head out to our respective colleges, we'll all be ready to go.
Mirko, how many players on that team, just for the listening audience to understand, how many players are you expecting to see in D1 schools next year?
Next year, I think we're going to have around Division I FBS schools. We're going to have around 10 to 12 guys, and that's not counting the juniors and seniors that have FBS offers.
Mirko, give us some idea of the agenda that you follow at the academy. What's all involved there?
Well, tomorrow we start off with a 6 a.m. lift. We lift every Monday and Wednesday during the season. And then we go to school. We run like a block schedule type college, kind of like how colleges are run. Mm-hmm. And school ends around 12:30. And then after that, we hang out till about 2:15 meeting starts. So then we go to the field house. We got meetings till about 3:30. Then we got practice. And debating whenever practice ends, then we're done for the day.
Mirko, you grew up in Big Ten country. You've got family ties to Notre Dame. Was that something you were looking at? Did you want to play kind of in that Big Ten footprint pretty close to home there in Indiana?
Oh, yeah, that was always the – I always wanted to go to a Big Ten school. I grew up rooting for Big Ten teams, loved watching them play. And so, yeah, that was always kind of the goal.
Do you know, Mirko, when you plan to take a visit to Nebraska? Are you going to be able to get up here for an official anytime soon?
Yeah, I'm taking my visit for when Nebraska plays Minnesota November 22nd, I believe.
All right. Mirko, congratulations so far on the season. Best of luck as you move forward. We look forward to seeing you in November.
Thank you for having me on the show.
We appreciate it. Mirko Jurkovic Jr. joining us here on Big Red Wrap-Up. We move from the Florida-Indiana combo to a little bit closer to home. We go west from Lincoln to Grand Island tonight for our in-state recruit.
Yeah, tonight we're talking about Grand Island Central Catholic defensive lineman Johanna Gaifon. And he's quite a story, guys. You know, he moved to this country from Sudan. I think they went from Sudan to Egypt, then to Atlanta, Georgia, then to Nebraska. And this kid has only been playing football for a couple of years, but really credit the coaches at Grand Island Central Catholic, Charlie Shoemaker, the football coach there, and Tino Martinez, the basketball coach. They have really taken this kid under their wing. They've developed him, and you know, they brought him out here to the Rivals camp in St. Louis. And I'll be honest, I was a little nervous. I'm like, you know, this is a new experience for a guy like this. How's he gonna do? And not only did he go in there and compete, he was one of the top guys. And I had several of the NFL coaches, former NFL coaches working the camp, tell me that this kid has so much upside and potential. He has things you can't coach and teach. And that's exactly what Craig Bull saw in this guy. Craig Bull said, if we take this guy in 2 years, people are going to say, how did Wyoming get this guy?
Sean, how much experience has he had playing football? I'm just watching the film right now. This guy's got some moves, man.
Yeah, he knows how to get skinny, you know, and common words, he knows how to get through blocks and uses his hands very well. He has great feet. He's a soccer player, also a great soccer player, leading scorer in basketball. He plays tight end. He's 6'3", 250. He's a dynamic athlete. And, you know, I know he came to Nebraska's camp. He ran a 4.8 40 at their camp, which was that was a good time for a lineman. I think he's going to be a great fit at Wyoming. The culture, the smaller campus feel might be good for him. And I think Wyoming got a pretty good one.
No, absolutely. The Nebraska coaches obviously got to see this guy up front and know that he's still developing. I mean, is there any chance that this guy is, how's his senior year going? I mean, is this the guy that's like, wait a second, we might take a second look at him?
Well, they're watching him. He hasn't been in any games that I know, and I think he's pretty solid. And the other thing is he's a defensive tackle, and Nebraska has the two twins out of Kansas City. And, you know, when you already have two four-star stud D tackles that are some of the best in the country, it's just hard to take another guy. But, you know, he's a guy that, trust me, if they could take him in a walk-on role or something, they would take him in a heartbeat. But guys like Craig Bull and Frank Solage at Wyoming and Ohio, they do a pretty good job of finding those guys in the state now.
Getting a lot of questions tonight, not necessarily about the recruiting aspect of this, but Bo Pelini speaking at his press conference earlier about the relationship between the SEC and the ESPN and saying that that's not something that he thinks is good for college football because there's a bias involved in that. And I'm paraphrasing Coach Pelini right now. In our final minute or two, Aide, just your overall thoughts on Coach Pelini's comments. I do love the fact that he's willing to say, speaks his mind. There's no question
Absolutely.
About that.
Absolutely. And he's right. The only thing that, as we all know at this level, economics is what it's all about.
Yeah.
And that's what we're talking about here. I mean, ESPN has a distinct economic interest in the SEC, so you expect them to do what they do. And so that's the way it is. But Bo's right. I mean, you'd like to see the thing be a little bit more fair and a little more sane, but it's not. But you just deal with it and move ahead.
Well, so much of this college football playoff is about a selection committee, you know, humans that are watching the television to figure out who's good. And ESPN is you're going to be one of your main sources of information, and they're going to show SEC because they have the footage. It's all theirs. They don't have to pay to show it to anybody. They're going to show SEC highlights. And when you see SEC, you hear SEC, and that's all they talk about, then you get to write down who's good and who's not. That's bias.
Guys, let me just Let me just say this on the committee. Do you really think Tom Osborne and Barry Alvarez, two of the 12 men in that room, are going to let the SEC biases? Barry Alvarez is going to bang his hand on a table.
I don't think anybody on that committee is going to be swayed by that sort of thing.
But there are folks that are not coaches. There are people that are just, you know, random citizens, not random citizens, but they're part of this committee.
Right.
That they're not watching the games like those coaches would.
You hope that they are. And I think all of this is conjecture right now until we see what actually happens. Luckily, the season does not end for a month plus, so we'll have time. Nebraska and Rutgers meet for the first time in over 90 years this Saturday. For a preview of that game and our predictions, head over to our Facebook page or the wrap-up website. Click the prediction. Adrian, Blake, and I will tell you exactly what to expect on Saturday. Nebraska takes on the Scarlet Knights, 11 a.m. on ESPN2. There's that SEC bias again. Next Tuesday, we'll have a recap of the Rutgers game, and we'll hear from our guest, Dr. Rob Rhodes, on the physics of sports injuries at 7 o'clock. Central Time. Our thanks tonight to Sean Callahan, Cory Ross, Ron Kellogg III, and Mirko Jurkovic Jr. for joining us tonight. Also thanks to Josh and the boys in the wrap-up call center. Now for Adrian and Blake, I'm Kevin. We'll see you right back here next Tuesday night on NET's Big Red Wrap-Up. Good night, everybody.